So today I'm going to talk about my work in particular and how we're beginning to use sensing systems in classrooms as a way to learn more about young children's development. I'm just going to start by saying thank you. I actually arrived yesterday at 3 a.m. From Ohio State University. It took me about 24 hours to get here. But it was a pleasure to fly for 24 hours, if you haven't done that before. And I just want to say thank you to Ante, professor here at NYU, for hosting me and taking care of everything. I am going to just point out that I don't work alone. I'm part of a very large team. I work with psychologists, educators, engineers, statisticians. I can't do any of this alone. So I'm going to talk about our work in early education classroom settings. If you've ever been in an early childhood classroom setting, they're really complicated environments. You've got 20, 25 little kids coming into school for the very first time. So there's nothing that has created homogeneity in them before when they first come into an early education setting. And I've been doing work in three areas that I'm going to walk you through and then talk about how we're using sensing systems now. So I'm going to talk about work called peer effects research, social network analysis, and then the population I'm most interested are children with language and social risk. And I'll talk a little bit more about that. I don't know a lot about preschool education in the UAE, but what this graph shows you is the percentage of 3 to 5 year olds enrolled in preschool education across 27 OECD countries. And so what you see across a lot of the world economy, you have upwards of 80, 90% of 3 to 5 year olds going to preschool in the years before primary education. And globally, this trend is increasing for a lot of reasons, but in part, certain economic literature that has shown that the return on investment of early childhood education, the return on investment lasts across the entire lifespan in terms of future earnings, future job potential, and the like. So we're seeing vast expansion of preschool education across the world. I study language development, and thinking about preschool classrooms in the context of language acquisition is really crucial because from the period of birth to five, language development is in an incredibly accelerated stage. So from birth to five, this is actually a visual of synaptogenesis. So this is basically the creation of neural pathways. And if you look at the black line, that is synaptogenesis for the brain region supporting language. And you see that very rapid acceleration of basically the building of neural pathways. And you have this rapid acceleration until about 2 years of age, and then we start to see this plateauing, declining effect. So the language system is being put in place from 0 to 5 years, and it's happening when we're putting all these little kids in classroom settings. And so we say that the child's brain is in an experience-dependent state. The child's brain, to shape these neural pathways that support language, we need experiences. And what we really need are what we would call high-quality experiences. So when we think about preschool classrooms, we have to think, are they of sufficient quality to help push the brain's development, not only in the region supporting language, but also self-regulation as well? We know, in part, that these preschool years are so important based on certain experiments that have been done, and I'm just alluding briefly to the Bucharest Orphanage study done about 2 decades ago, where this actually took place in Romania, A team of researchers led by Charles Nelson at Harvard did a randomized controlled trial where children were taken out of orphanages and put into higher quality caregiving settings, basically foster homes. And they were able to look at language and cognitive development for children who were placed in better caregiving environments versus remaining in the orphanage, and showed a significant boost in cognition and language that lasted through follow-ups into the 20s. So we know that early experiences are really critical, based not only on lots of correlational research, but even experimental evidence. I'm concerned with children who have language difficulties. Language difficulties can come because a child has a developmental disability. Epidemiological data indicate that about 10% of kids have basically brain-based difficulties that give rise to impaired language skills that persist into adulthood. So developmental disabilities affect young children, and then also poverty. There's very clear evidence that being raised in a low-income home, because of the circumstances within that home, it also appears to impede language development. And so what you have here is a measure, or you have two basically brain images for children who varied in terms of the amount of language stimulation they were getting. So on the left side, you have a child who's experiencing 95 conversational turns per hour with their caregiver, back and forth on average 95 times, versus on the right, you have 210 conversational turns. And what you see on the right is you have greater functional connectivity in the areas of the brain that support language. Again, showing that stimulation, in this case, in the form of back and forth conversational exchanges, is driving brain functionality. And I'm just going to go back for 1 second to show you when we look at Romanian orphanages, you know, this is the product of a dictatorship that went on. Many kids were put in orphanage care. And what's unique about Romanian orphanages is the very, very little back and forth interaction that young kids have with adults. You usually have one adult caring for a number of children, and their position is really not to interact with kids so that they stay quiet. And you also have a lot of rotation of caregivers, so you don't have one adult engaging regularly with the child. And so what you see here is that, again, the brain is in this experience, expectant or dependent state, and you have a child developing from 0 to 5, isn't having a lot of responsive interactions with adults or children, and you see the brain being affected. When we think about language difficulties in young children, one of the reasons we need to be so concerned is because it has a lot of adverse outcomes. So when you have kids who have poor language skills at 3, 4, and 5, we tend to see them be victimized and excluded from peer networks. They don't have really good language skills, so they're not good at entering conversations. They say the wrong things. So they have a high tendency for peer rejection. They have a high tendency for behavioral problems, including externalizing and internalizing, a very high susceptibility for reading difficulties, and what you tend to see is chronic academic underachievement. So when we have kids, you know, in this period of really rapid brain development in the early years, and we see language difficulties emerging, we really need to be quite concerned because there's a lot of adversities down the road that are linked with early language issues. So I'm going to shift to some research we've been doing, and I'm going to start by talking about peer effects research. So peer effects is a phenomenon that was originally of real interest to economists, but it's now become of more interest to developmental psychologists. Peer effects research is the study of how much are our behaviors or skills affected by those around us. So, for instance, we are nested. You are so nested right here in your little NYU bubble. you have to ask, are NYU students influenced by behavior of other NYU students? So anytime we have clustering of people in a neighborhood, in a university, in a city, in a classroom, peer effects research asks, how much are we influenced by those around us? So, you know, we can think, do peers matter? This is my son. He is a world-class musician who goes around and performs all over the U.S. This is him last summer. But we can think about if you're a kid and all your friends are musicians, are you more likely to become a musician than if your friends weren't? If your peers study hard, are you more likely to study hard? If your friends drink alcohol, are you more likely to drink alcohol? If your peers are gamers, I mean, we should all be concerned about how much kids are spending on technology. My son is also a gamer. All of his friends are gamers. So peer effects research is, again, systematically studying how the peers around an individual influence their subsequent behavior. I'm interested in peer effects in early childhood because in preschool classrooms, kids spend a lot of time with other children. This is one very large study in the United States of what happens in preschool classrooms. And what you see is 34% of the time is in meals and routines, nothing teacher-led, and free choice. So about 60-65% of the time, kids are roaming around hanging out with little peer groups. So we should ask the question for a preschool kid in a classroom, how much are they being shaped by the characteristics of other kids that they're interacting with? So I'm going back a little bit in time. We did one of the first studies of the peer effects phenomenon in preschool classrooms. And again, I'm interested in language. So our question was, does a child's language growth over a year, is it influenced by the language skills of their classmates? Does that make sense? And so we had a sample of 1,812 kids in a lot of different classrooms, and we said, how much does a kid's language growth depend on the language skills of their classmates or their peers? And what we saw was a significant effect. So to put it really simply, if we're predicting spring language, I had a little thing. I don't know where it went. Oh, here it is. So if we're predicting spring language here, whoa, that's weird. Okay. So if we're predicting spring language here, you see spring language controlling for fall language is higher for kids whose peers have high language. So you see end of spring, a child's language outcomes is higher if their classmates have higher language skills. It's lower if their classmates have lower skills. This study has been replicated quite a few times in preschool classrooms. You get different outcomes like self-regulation, attention, and what you see is kids' language, social, emotional skills are influenced by the skill levels of their peers. Again, I'm really interested in kids with disabilities, so we tested the peer effects phenomenon in special education preschool classrooms. We had 670 kids across 83 classrooms. About half of the kids in these classrooms had diagnosed disabilities. They included autism, language impairment, Down syndrome, developmental delay, a very heterogeneous group of kids with disabilities. And what we saw was a really strong peer effect. So what you have here, I don't think this is going to work, but again, this is predicted spring scores as a function of the skill levels in their classrooms. So I circled the bottom row. It says, yes, IEP. That means, yes, the children have a disability. So in the U.S., kids who have disabilities have what's called an individual education plan. So if you have an IEP, it means that's the group of kids with disabilities. And what you see is for kids with disabilities who were in classrooms where their peers had really high language skills, look all the way to the right. They have the highest peers is on the right side. Kids with disabilities who had highly skilled peers in the area of language outperformed kids with disabilities whose peers had low levels of skills to the magnitude of a very large effect. So this, again, this is all correlational. We're not randomly assigning kids to have highly skilled peers or not, but the pattern in all these studies, it has really pretty profound impact. So for instance, let's say you're a mom and you have a four-year-old child with a disability and you want your child to go to preschool and the school principal says, I'm going to put your kid in a classroom only with other kids with disabilities. They're not going to make as much growth as if they were surrounded by lots of kids who don't have disabilities who have higher level language skills because of that peer effect, if that makes sense. All this work, lots of people are doing this in lots of different fields. This work is really limited, and I'm going to lead you on the path towards why we're using sensing systems. So this peer effect phenomenon, we consistently see it in preschool classrooms all the way up to college classrooms. We see peer effects impact a lot of different outcomes. When we look at college students, we see effects on GPA. When we look at little kids, we see effects on social-emotional skills, language, and even numeracy. But the problem is what we're doing is basically looking at changes in kids' skills from one point to another as a function of the skills of their peers. But we don't actually know who kids are interacting with. So we're making a lot of inferences. So the question is, number one, can we leverage peers who have high skills to improve the skills of children who are struggling? And what peers are most influential? And I would say the most important question is, what's actually the mechanism taking place? So the next thing we've been doing is trying to use social network analysis to find out if the kids interact with in the classroom social network, if that's the driver of this peer effect. So social network analysis is basically when you apply it to a classroom. So what you're doing is basically looking at a classroom in terms of how it's structured with respect to the network or the connections between nodes in a network. So here you have, that's what we would call a very dense network, where you have all the kids are really connected. This is what we have, a centered network. These are both preschool classrooms, and here you have a network. Well, that's not going to work. Here you have a classroom. This is probably a popular girl right in the middle. That's the popular girl classroom. You've got a little girl. Everybody's connected. And the kid I'm worried about is where? That kid in the corner. That is called an isolate. That is called peer rejection. And that is called victimization. A child being pushed to the fringe of a social network is a form of victimization. Whether the kids are doing it on purpose is unclear. Probably not. These are little kids. But that is called an isolate, and we should be always very concerned about isolates. I'm concerned about isolates because of that peer effect phenomenon. If I'm developing language skills as a function of the peers around me, that child only has one child they're interacting with. So we've been looking at social networks in preschool classrooms as a way to understand these peer effects. When we study social networks in preschool classrooms, the common way to do it is child report. And so that's called a peer nomination task, where you give a child a picture of all the classmates, and you say, which children do you play with, basically? Which kids do you fight with? It's called a peer nomination task. Another way we do this is a teacher report, where we basically give teachers a grid, and they rate how often every child plays or fights. The other report that is used less often than teacher and child is researcher observations, where you sit and you actually mark every time everybody interacts with others. Even though this would seem the best, it's rarely done because it is so cumbersome. These are actually three social networks that we captured in each of these three ways in one classroom. And what you see is the overall look of the social network is very similar. Like, look here, 13 is an isolate based on children and observers, but the teacher got it wrong and thinks that isolate has connections that don't exist. The overall structure of the social network looks similar, but there's a lot of details that are off, which is why I'm going to shift in a little bit to talk about newer approaches using technology to capture social networks. I do want to point out that these are 83 preschool classrooms for which we captured the social network based on teacher report. Every one of those black nodes is a child who has a disability. And one of the things we see is that kids with disabilities tend to be pushed to the edges of the classroom social networks. So if you look over here, you have those two black nodes. They're kind of pushed to the side. And in general, what we see is kids with language disorders tend to be isolated. They're more likely to be isolated from the social network, which then can rob them of the chance to mine these peer effects. So one of the questions we've been asking is, does the social network drive that peer effect? So like right here, you have this isolate who's really only getting language exposure from one other child. Then you have this child up there who's getting language exposure from four or five different kids. The thicker the line, the more kids are interacting. So you would think that that child is going to grow more in language than this child because of that position within the social network and presumably getting more language input as a function of interacting with other kids. So one question we've been asking in this paper that came out just a couple years ago is that peer effect driven by the child's social network? In other words, here, maybe this visual will help. These are actually four kids in a social network, very small social network. And imagine that those numbers are the child's language skills. So 50 is better language skills than 45. So we can basically say, is this child's language growth over the year driven by the language skills of the kids they most interact with? And in fact, that's exactly what we found. For kids with disabilities, their language growth was basically conditioned on the language skills of the kids that they interacted with a lot. And it might have only been one kid, it could have been three, could have been five. But we see that that social network is the driver of these peer effects. But again, there's so many limitations in this type of work. Most social network analysis papers are only looking at kids' social network position one point in time, like just in the fall of the year, just in the spring of the year, because this is really hard to do. And we're almost always relying on child and teacher report and not real-time looking in a classroom at the interactions taking place. The other thing is these don't actually capture the interactions that are taking place that are presumably the mechanism through which kids are influencing each other. And then the most important point, in developmental research, we almost always have relied on sitting and watching things and coding them. And it's brutal, it's expensive, and it takes years. So that is not the way that we need to go to do this kind of work. So the question we've been pursuing is, how can technology help us? And I have, you see, this is, my mom has called me. This is, what, about 5 years ago. And my phone transcribes what she said. And it's pretty good, right? if phones can do that, can't we do classroom-based research in a way that's more sophisticated than looking at kids one time and relying on teacher and child report? There's got to be a way. I know that other fields are so far ahead of us. Like, if you go into hospitals, everything is tagged. Everybody's watching everything moving through hospitals because that's an incredibly profitable industry, and they can invest in lots of cool technologies to make hospital care and monitoring hospital products. They can do this really well. We haven't seen that type of investment in child development research. So sensing systems are systems that utilize continuous data. So going back to social networks, ideally we could watch children continuously as they move around a classroom, monitor who they're talking to, know a lot about who they're talking to, and see the drivers of development in real time. The thing that's really exciting to me is I could see a future where the teachers are receiving these real-time data. So in a perfect world, the teacher would see something that says, Laura is isolated. Nobody's talking or playing with her all day. Go and intervene. That's where I hope this goes. So sensing data that's being used in other fields provides a remarkable opportunity to do better research and to design better educational interventions. So I saw a paper that came out about 4 years ago about researchers at Carnegie Mellon who had developed a massive sensing system that they put in a college classroom. And this is actually their pipeline. They put cameras, all sorts of things in this classroom, and they develop, well, here they have a student-facing camera, an instructor-facing camera, and then they have all these modules that are looking at students' faces, looking at posture, and so they're extracting all these features from the videos, and the ideal strategy by looking at poses, gestures, faces, is the instructor would know, okay, half of your class is completely unengaged right now. You better do something. And so I was looking at my mom's messages being transcribed on my phone. I saw this paper come out by these researchers at Carnegie Mellon, and I said to all my colleagues, I said, we have got to start moving in this direction. And I'm going to tell you, the hardest part of moving in this direction, if you're someone who does development or researcher, is finding an engineer to work with you. Because number one, at Ohio State, all of our engineering students are making a lot of money as students working for Google, Amazon, and Facebook. They're not going to come and work for me for whatever an hour. They're in great demand, but I happen to find a couple engineers who are really interested in social justice. That's a big movement now, engineering for social justice, and they're really concerned with early childhood and kids at risk, and so I was able to get them to work with me. It's not always the easiest collaboration, engineers and scientists. But if our heart is in the right place, we can make it work. So we have been working over the last 3 or 4 years really trying to push the envelope and thinking about how we can design sensing systems for the type of work we do. And we actually just had this paper come out last month that we describe all the different technologies that are out there and the way these can be deployed in classroom settings. So classroom sensing systems, usually what you'll see are people using voice recorders, like automated voice recorders, location trackers, cameras, heart rate monitors, oximeters, et cetera. And what you can take any combination of these, and you're trying to capture information about multiple children simultaneously. The key to these sensing systems is they have to be designed for the very noisy, messy environment of classrooms. So like a lot of people have heard of a tool that's out there called Lena. That is not to be used in a classroom. It also has very high error rates, and it's incredibly expensive. So we're starting to see more open source tools come out that we're playing with. The thing that's really challenging about this, I know we have an aspiring computer scientist back there. The thing that's really hard about this is the vast amount of data you get. It's really hard to deal with developmental scientists, we're kind of used to, okay, if you get 100 kids and data on each one, that feels like a lot. We're dealing with data that we don't even know how to work with yet. So our interest is really language exchanges within a classroom, kids' position in a social network, and how those might be drivers of language development. So some of the, I mentioned Lena. This is an audio recording device. It's very proprietary. They were designed simply to capture basically vocal exchanges in a home environment. RealSense, UbiSense is a location tracker. Empatica, and basically what we're doing is equipping kids with these and then following them around. And there's probably about 3 research teams doing this kind of work right now in early childhood. Our very first effort to do this, I'll briefly mention this, is we had every kid in the classroom wear a GoPro on their head. That was our first foray. We had the teachers wear GoPros. And what we found out is that GoPros actually get really hot, and they were burning the kids' heads. So we decided that we weren't going to do GoPros anymore. But the GoPro study, we had all the little kids and the teachers wear these for, well, they get really hot at the 2-hour point. So we got about up to 2 hours of recording. But that was enough to develop our pipeline for processing, in this case, because we had cameras, we had video and audio data. And then you have to develop this pipeline to basically extract all the features of video audio data. And this CDS means child-directed speech. So we wanted to capture all the speech being directed towards the child by either teachers or peers. So this was good for allowing us to develop the beginning of a pipeline for processing and figuring out, like, can we use Amazon Web Service? Can we, you know, what should we use for automatic speech recognition? Where are we going to store these data? How do we deal with this volume of data? When you do all this work, you always have to establish ground truth. So ground truth in our GoPro study is actually transcribing each video, diarizing it. This is the teacher, this is this child. You develop ground truth, sort of human-coded accuracy, and then you train your system, basically with machine learning, to then be able to process your data automatically. And so what you see, this is just one of the things we had to do, is get our system to differentiate an adult from a child, cheating things like face size, height, vocal frequency, et cetera. And so against ground truth, just for determining it's a child versus an adult, we got greater than 80% accuracy. I'm just looking at the accuracy numbers. So that was our first foray. We then spent a lot of time. We really needed a system that was not overly expensive, because we want to use this in a lot of classrooms. We also needed it to be tolerable to teachers and children. So I can tell you right now that if you walk into a preschool classroom and you say, I'm going to put in a system that captures everything you're doing, a lot of teachers are going to say, no way. And a lot of parents are going to say, no way. So the first thing we did is we decided there's no way we're getting images. No way are we using video anymore. Too much privacy issue. So what we did is we have stationary antennas around the classroom. They look like this. And the kids wear a pouch. We actually played with a lot of things. We had kids wearing a baseball cap with RFID tags. We had kids wearing necklaces. Eventually, we ended up with a pouch. This is one of our, well, this kid is wearing a Bluetooth to hook them up to the antennas so we can see where they're moving. And then we have a voice-activated recorder in the pouch. And that's the system that we're really sticking with. Sorry, I went the wrong way. Okay. So we have Bluetooth beacons, which are picking up at where everybody goes. And we have voice-activated recorders that they're wearing. And we did a lot to get the cheapest recorders that we could get that had reasonable accuracy. So as I mentioned, every kid wears this. So we're actually monitoring every child. And a kid is considered in proximity to another based on being 1.5 meters of each other in a 45-degree rotation. So we can actually capture all talk directed towards a child and all talk going out from a child as well as adults in the classroom. This is what we call the system. We call it ideas, interaction detection, something. I can never remember it. And so this is our pipeline. You have the proximity log. We run on the observation. We run ideas, which captures who's talking to who, is it an adult, is it a kid? And then at the end, we have speech processing software. It's all uploaded to the cloud or automatic speech recognition. And then we literally get a detail of every word and utterance coming out of a kid's mouth to another child or the teacher and coming in. So one of the things I'm just going to show you briefly, we're still in the middle of this. The first trial, we implemented our system in 12 classrooms. We had 12 teachers who agreed to wear the technology and 113 kids. We are allowed to do active and passive consent. So active consent means the parent says, yes, you can be in the study. Yes, you can test my kid. You can do all your stuff with our kids. Passive consent kids just wear the technology, and we capture nothing else about them. And our IRB allows us to use passive consent more than I'm surprised how often they let us do it, which means we tell the parents, your child's going to wear this technology. We're not going to do anything else. If you don't send this back, we're going to have your kids wear the technology. So that does allow us to get a full representation of the whole classroom social network. And I'm just going to show you data for one day of recording very quickly. I mentioned we get a lot of data. I just wanted to give you, this is like one itty-bitty tiny sliver. This is actually every interaction captured for, this is like 5 minutes for subject 11. And you have every single interaction with another child identified. And then we get how many auxiliary verbs were produced, how many conjunctions, how many verbs, how many nouns, how many turns back and forth. And so you have to turn, I mean, this just goes on for a million pages, and you have to figure out how to deal with it as a social scientist. So I'm just going to give you a snippet, and then I'm going to move on because I know we're getting to the end. So this is classroom one. These are our classrooms. This is classroom one on this side, and classroom one here is if you're closing a book. So if we just look at classroom one, this is each one of those dots is a child, and that is just how much outgoing talk that child is producing to another child, and this is how much incoming talk. That's just a tiny, tiny sliver of what we're getting. But what we can also do is, because we know every child who a child is interacting with, we can actually create social networks. And so these are two different classrooms. So this is a child, and the bigger the node, the more incoming and outgoing talk to other children. And the lines represent who they're interacting with. So, like, now what you see is that little node that I drew a line to. That child across this whole day actually produced no talk and received none. And so you can start to see we can identify isolates in a classroom social network based on much more reliable information that represents a full day. And we can do this every day and get to the point where we can actually visualize social network change over the course of a year. Nobody's ever done that before. I'm not saying we're great. I do have a great team. But historically, we have like one classroom watched three times over a year. And then we make huge inferences. So I'm going to just shift to the final point, which is going back to when I shared my real passion is how can we help kids who have language difficulties and who are socially excluded. That's a really dangerous combination for kids. Kids who have language issues early in life and who are socially excluded, those often go hand in hand. There's a lot of adversities in their future, possibly. Okay, that peer exclusion can just continue. Lots of risks imposed by that early peer exclusion. So one of the things we've been doing is testing an intervention used in preschool classrooms. We call it PEERS, the PEERS intervention. And what we do is we go into a classroom and we test all the kids. So we know the child who has the lowest language skills in the classroom. And then we have the teachers do a social network grid so we can find the child who's most isolated. So we're looking in a classroom for the child with the lowest language skills who's most isolated. And then what we do is we identify two buddies in these classrooms. The buddies are kids who have really good language skills and really good social skills. In each week, three times, the teacher works with the buddies and the focal children to teach the buddies strategies to help the focal child play. The three strategies the buddies are taught are invite the target child to play, talk to the target child about what you're doing, and praise the target child, usually by high fives. Okay? So the buddies are taught these things. Remember, these are little kids being taught these peer-mediated strategies. So we've been using the sensing system now as a way to look at intervention effects. So we over the course of about 10 weeks, we did all-day recordings in the classrooms. On average, we got about 104 minutes that was focused in on playtime because that's where we really want to see these mechanisms at work. And our variables are incoming talk and outgoing talk. It's that simple. We want kids to be talked to, and we want them to be talking to others. So using our sensing system, this is just one classroom. This is a baseline 2 weeks where we just watched our focal kid, and we're looking at incoming, or this is time spent in proximity to peers, the buddies, and then other kids in the classroom. And what you see, again, these are purely from sensing data using proximity data captured 9 times over about as many weeks. What you see is not much is happening here in terms of proximity to other kids, but you do see this boost start happening at about week 6, 7, 8. You see this real dip at 9 when the intervention's coming to a close. That suggests maybe we can't close the intervention. We have to keep working with the buddies. Because I'm going to skip to this one. So what I did here is I did this last night. I pulled the raw data for 2 classrooms. We have a control classroom and we have a treatment classroom. I only pulled data from 1 classroom for each, and I just randomly picked a treatment and a control classroom. And these are, and I picked 3 time points over the multiple recordings. So this is, I did control day 1, the first, at the beginning of the intervention. I had to do treatment, I had to do session 2 here. These are, the blue are the focal kids, green are the buddies. And in treatment session 1, the focal kid was absent, so it wouldn't be a good comparison. Then I have week 5, and then I have week 7. So this is real sensing data capturing ingoing and outgoing talk when kids are in proximity in the classroom. So in the control classrooms, the teacher is not implementing this peers intervention. What you see is the focal child, this is the child with the lowest language skills, most isolated. That focal child, the big blue node, they're actually getting, they're showing a lot of ingoing and outgoing talk. I don't know why that happened on that observation day. But then what you see is it decreases over time. Remember, the bigger the node is, the more talk coming in. We see an opposite phenomenon in this treatment classroom. So here's our focal kid. These buddies, remember, they're picked because they have really good language skills and they're really part of the classroom social network. And what you see is that child, that focal child, over time seems to show a trend towards getting more and more incoming and outgoing talk. And these data, I find this really interesting because it's much more revealing than me going in and trying to tally something one day, you know, with all my human error. So this is hot off the press. We didn't have time to pull the data from all the classrooms and study and then collapse them and see if these types of patterns hold. I will promise you, though, I did not cherry pick. I literally pulled a control classroom, a treatment classroom, pulled the network and laid them out on this slide. So I was pretty excited at least at what looked like a trend. So a concluding thought, the first thing I'm going to say is if you think studying classrooms is easy and not real science, it's not true. These places are a mess. These kids are real. They're very complicated environments, but what's happening to them is crucial in this really important period of the lifespan. We have good evidence of peer effects operating through social networks, but they're drawn from really sort of superficial looks at what's happening, and we're making really big inferences. So I'm really excited about the potential for sensing systems to provide us a really deep and wide lens into not only development, but also our intervention. So thank you very much. I think I'm right on time. Yeah.